Hey, what's up everybody? My name is Trophynut and welcome back to Bioshock 2 in our Let's Replay series. We're still at the Atlantic Express, just arrived here actually, and we need to make our way upstairs towards Bridget Tenenbaum, who should be able to help us with our problem. So let's check out a few of the lockers. And this is actually really cool. This is actually kind of the locker room for the big daddies. I know I kind of mentioned that in the previous game they said that they couldn't remove their helmets. This room kind of indicates that they should be able to, because this looks like the place where the big daddies came in, or actually the guys in diving suits came in and undressed again after they worked outside. Kind of nice bit of a detail. Let's see if we can't do anything else here. Nothing in particular, but we can clearly hear the splicer that we just saw running away when we entered this place. Safety first indeed. So there we go, there's the splicer, and he's gonna lock the door. I think I can't even kill him if I wanted to. So he's gonna just close the door. Yeah, okay, there we go.
Now most who survive are like this. Splicers. They're drug addicts, vicious animals.
Yes, indeed they are, but we kind of already knew that from the previous game. So now this door is locked, but we need to get through. So the game already indicates we need to pick up a hack tool. So there we go. So hack tool, easy as that. You got the hack tool, press R2 to fire it at machines to subvert them to your sides. So instead of just hacking manually, now we can actually hack from a distance. So this thing also uses ammo. We can just put that in there, and then we get a mini game to where we need to stop the needle at the right time. There we go. Open up the gate, and it's unlocked. There we go. Distance hacker, another trophy earned. Can I actually get more of these? I don't think I can. I think I can only do that as long as I didn't open the door. So there we go. A nice bit of information of how this works with a hack signal. Transmitted to the dart you send into the robotic enemies, kind of explaining how that should work. But of course we can also proximity hack, as they call it, just hacking normally, and that works in the same way. Stopping in a blue area gives us a bonus, so in this case hacking the blue area upgrades the damage of these bots. And there we go, so I can switch between those things again. Again, we will be reborn. Kind of indicating what Lamb is up to, without spoiling too much, of course. So let's see what else is there. We see the shadow of the splicer again, kind of making this a bit creepy. Don't think there's anything around here. Okay, so let's follow him around. And apparently, there's he's gone. Yeah, he's nowhere to be found, but this thing just drops down. I can clearly hear someone. Ah, there he is. And there we go. Let's punch him in the face. Oh, you fool. Nope, I'm just gonna punch you into submission. There we go.
This is Dr. Sophia Lamb.
Yes, that is.
Andrew Ryan is dead. But the tyrant dwells within us all. Remember. We reject the gene. We reject the self. We reject the tyrant.
So as you can hear from herself, she, Sophia Lamb is actually an opposer of individualism. The end of Ryan is the end of the self. She wants to put the focus on the family, as she calls it, as everybody's grouping together. Nothing wrong with that per se. But the way she goes around to doing that is a bit worse than you might think. So, more rivets and another audio diary. The Great Chain rattles.
I'm told that the people grow tense and isolated in the absence of the sun. Now they clamor for a psychiatrist. Do they miss the state censor, I wonder? Wartime seizure of private assets? Or the Cheka police vanishing them in the night? Regardless, this Lamb woman is said to be the foremost practitioner in her field. Fine. If she can quiet the rattling of the Great Chain's weakest links, I will leave her to it.
So an interesting bit of Andrew Ryan indicating how Sophia Lam actually got her power, how she started out as a simple psychiatrist who helped people deal with, their psychological issues because they didn't see the sun anymore, etc., etc. So that's how she started out as. And she clearly took her opportunity after Ryan died by our hands. Well, not our hands per se right now, because not our hands as the Big Daddy, but of course our hands as Jack Ryan. There we go. So we're in a sort of security booth. We want to open this large gate over there. So we're going to open that with this switch over here. And this is another really cool scene, because this kind of reminds us to the scene at the beginning of Bioshock 1, where Andrew Ryan has a similar introduction.
That symbol on your hand marks you a dead man. 10 years, Subject Delta, since I watched you put a gun to your head and pull the trigger. But take heart. Out of your pain, paradise was born. I don't know how you survived, but your suffering is over now. These men will ease your burden. Please understand that, like all I have done, this is an act of love.
So there we have a very important piece of information.
It is Sophia Lam. She has found you.
Our name, actually. Is that... Wait, what? What are they firing at? Because it looks like they're firing at the bot. Did my bot actually gain access to the back room there? But the floor caves in and therefore giving us an exit out. So yeah, our name is Subject Delta, because we have the Delta, the Greek's Delta symbol on our hand, indicating that we... Well, there were a few predecessors, as it might seem. Because if we're Delta, then there are a few Greek letters before us. I think there are a few corpses hanging around here, if I'm not mistaken. So yeah, Sophia Lam thinks this is an act of love. She still recognizes us from 10 years ago. Recognizes that she murdered us 10 years ago, and that apparently didn't take. Death didn't take, as a Reaper from Overwatch would
say. Now you know of the enemy we share.
It.
Sophia Lam. The camera in your helmet allows me to watch through your eyes and help you to fight her.
So yeah, we have a camera in our helmet explaining how Tenenbaum can see what we see. And that allows her to watch through our eyes, as she said it. So, look at that, the masquerade ball of 1959 when everything went to shit. There we go, out of the water again. And then I think over there, yeah, there's an audio diary over there. I think I should be able to just reach it. Or not. Can't even jump right now. Yeah, I think that I'm gonna have to return for that. So, yeah, okay. And there we have the butterfly symbol again with the palm prints this time. So we should be getting closer to where we need to be. We did drop down, so we need to go up again. If we wanna go back to the station. And as you might already hear, there's a camera nearby. There we go.
Careful, security cameras belong to Lam. But if you are clever, they can be made to serve you.
Okay, so same way as it worked in the previous game, we can hack these as well. And there we go, blue bonus in for cameras increases the time the alarm rings when it detects an enemy. There we go.
Go ahead.
Nope. Hi. There we go. Down with him. Kind of failed the effect of the camera there, though. It didn't detect the guys over here, so that was kind of sad. Let's go back to the rivet gun so we have at least something to shoot with. And then let's take a look around. God damn it, Bolt. You're in my way. Kind of. So it looks like offices. What was that? I thought I heard something outside. Just plain offices of the train station. Because, of course, we're in the back of the train station where the carts were repaired and such. Okay, kind of skip forward there. Nothing that you missed. Just wanted to loot a few of the containers and there were a lot of them. So, Workshop 6B. We want to head over there eventually, but there's something here in the Jet Postal Office first that might be of interest. Another gift of Eleanor.
Father, it's me, Eleanor. I know you're awake in there. I can feel it. Mother won't be able to toy with you like that ever again. This plasmid is for you. If I'm right, you can use it now. Please, find me.
So thank you, Eleanor. Another plasmid for us. So as you know from the previous game, a Big Daddy and his little sister share a bond, a genetic bond. And currently, Eleanor is using that bond to talk to us kind of telepathically. Kind of explains that. She also mentions that she removed our influence, well, the way Lamb influenced us using the hypnotized Big Daddy plasmid, so we couldn't be influenced like that anymore, so she wouldn't be able to make us shoot ourselves in the head again. So, let's take the plasmid, because this is telekinesis. There we go, pick up big stuff with your mind, throw it at your enemies. What else do you need to know? Indeed, couldn't agree more.
Throw objects at foes. You can even catch grenades and throw them back.
Sounds like a plan. There we go, now we have telekinesis as well. We can actually train this as well, same as we could in the previous game, because the jet postal tube over there has broken down the pneumotube, and if I activate it, I can actually catch something. There we go. Really, really nicely done. I'm still gonna get pelted by items over here, but no biggie, no biggie. Now that we have telekinesis, I think we can grab that audio diary on the left behind that air vent. There we go. And if we wait for the opening... Oh, okay, never mind. Don't even need to wait for the opening.
Hello, Mr. Diary. Want to play?
Actually, I'm quite busy right now, Miss Eleanor. Maybe later.
Well, all right. But do you mind if I take you apart while I wait? I promise I'll put you back together.
Wait! You can't do that! No!
Wait! Wait, Eleanor!
Kinda makes me laugh every time. So that's Eleanor Lamb herself with a little audio diary where she takes apart the audio diary while she's recording to it. Not really good for the material, I think. But now we can take the stairs up here. She knows the way. Written in blood. So yeah, Sophia Lamb kind of knows the way, apparently. And there's three splicers over there, talking it out. But we're gonna just blow them up. What the hell? Oh, holy shit. Okay, there's a lot of splices here, and apparently they don't die after one explosion. Okay, let's switch to Electro Bolt. Because they can't really get me here. Okay, are they still fighting the... Okay. I must say, droid, your drone, you're really impressing me today. That was really nicely done. He took out two splices on his own. So, just a fad.
There would be no rupture without me. No city without the Atlantic Express. Ryan took his first grand tour on my flagship coach. These days, personal bathyspheres are all the rage. My rails only connect the oldest parts of Rapture now. And the city's just left me behind. Plenty of cash in the bank, though. This private vehicle craze will blow over soon.
And right he was, because Andrew Ryan later restricted the Batisphere travel to his own offspring. That was the reason we were the only one able to use the Batisphere. Let's see, she's dead, but I can't do anything about that, apparently. Can I loot any of these guys? Apparently not. Maybe that one? Maybe that one? Nope. Okay, tiny bit. There we go. So let's head through here. As usual, I'm just gonna whack these things. Nope, whack him. Whack him. There we go. Health packs for us. Let's go to the back of this place, the Railway Cafe. Interesting, interesting. Not that much around here, but I think there's an interesting audio diary at the end of this room. In the kitchen, if I'm not mistaken. Hello? Hello, hello, hello. I think in the back here. Yeah, over here. Ryan versus Lamb. Reality.
White is not black, Dr. Lamb. Down is not up, and straw is not gold. Look around you. Rapture is no miracle. It is a product of reason. Impossible unless one and one are two, and A equates to A.
And yet, alone, each man is a prisoner to bias, dream, delusion, or the pain of a phantom limb. To one man, they are as real as rain. Reality is consensus, and the people are losing faith. Take a walk, Andrew. It is raining in Rapture, and you have simply chosen not to notice.
And there we have the first confrontation between the two, kind of a political debate. And I think I heard a few splices entering the room. Let's just eat our fill first, and then let's take a look. Let's take one of the gas canisters. There we go, I think that took them out. Yeah, okay, because the other ones didn't really die immediately from that. Were kind of tough splices, the other ones in the central area over here. Let's take a look further. I'm just gonna take... okay, apparently I'm just gonna take dollars. Not anything that I wanted to take, but hey. We're gathering a nice amount of dollars. Let's use the Eve dispenser here. Can I actually reload? Huh. Use Eve Hyper now, yeah. That way, since we now can equip everything at the same time, it's kind of hard to see otherwise. So, I think we just need to enter this place first. And then that happens. And we can see what happens here. A splicer jams the mechanism with a pipe.
Sophia Lamb is using the splicers against you. Most big daddies are like her slaves, guarding the little ones. But someone has awakened you.
Yes, indeed, someone has awakened us. But what happened to the people? From our dear friend Mark Meltzer.
These people are hooked on some kind of genetic wonder drug called Adam. I've read the word splicer scribbled on walls like a warning. One of them cornered me and, Christ, his face! I had a gun, but I choked. And then out of nowhere, we both heard this singing. And he took off like hell on wheels. It sounded like a kid. A little girl. Cindy's alive. I know it in my gut.
Yeah, she is alive, but she kind of turned into a little sister. So let's grab the pipe out of the mechanism. And now the gate opens on its own again. Thank you very much. Allowing us to move further. And now we can't use the Eve dispenser anymore.
I know of your bond with Eleanor Delta. To save yourself, you will come for her. But Eleanor has a destiny, one you cannot share. There is no place for you in paradise.
Oh, but I like paradise. Why aren't I welcome in paradise? That's a bit sad. Are you discriminating against big daddies? And here we have another audio diary. Know the beasts.
In ethical psychiatry, we must account for the role of evolution. Depression, fits of panic, sexual pathos, all responses to ancient selection pressure. The irony is that this theory is why Ryan's people invited me here. They mistake my study of natural law for the worship of competition. Remember, Eleanor, one must know the beast before it can be slain.
So a message to her daughter, Eleanor, indicating what she... she's kind of shaping Eleanor's morals a bit, because it's actually the first time Lamb actually mentions that she has plans for Eleanor, that she has a greater scheme plans for her. Let's take another look around. I think there's something in the corner here as well, kind of dark. Okay, apparently nothing. Let's jump over this. There's another corpse here on the mattress. Another one in the corner, nothing of interest it seems, so yeah. That's that, so let's head on further, and there we have our first circuits of value, the first defending machine. So these things haven't changed one bit, so let's hack them. Okay. I think blue bonus while hacking to drop a free item, there we go. So that's what I was confusing it with when I was playing Bioshock 1, because it's only in Bioshock 2 that they drop extra items if you hack them. Never mind. So now they also change the audio when you hacked it, so that they sound a bit distorted. Don't really need that much. I think I'm gonna buy a first aid kit just in case, because we do have an annoying area coming up. So there we go. Switching hub. So that should allow us to get higher again. Hi! Now we have Big Sister again. For some reason, just jumping in front of our face and then running away. There's also a camera over there. I wonder if I can... Yeah, I can.
Quickly!
There we go.
Head for the elevator!
I always wondered why we need to be quick, because... The quicker we go, the more splices we spawn, so... go. That was about 5 splices, so if your defenses are set up correctly, you can easily make it out of this place, but you need to be careful. I think there's a few more. There we go. Is this one dead or is he still alive? I thought... Yeah, okay, he's burning to death. So let's take a quick look around. Looks like there's another health station here, so let's whack this to death. Thank you. 4 out of 5. Which is really, really nice. Is there something else? Any audio diaries? Yeah, I don't really know why they say that you need to hurry, because you clearly don't need to hurry. Why would we do that? For God's sakes, let's just take a good look around that we don't miss anything, and then let's head into the elevator. Okay. What are you gonna do? Whack the fence? Yeah, let the camera deal with that and the bolt. Ooh, that's a lot of splices. No, don't shoot.
Now, here is what the children tell me. You are a very old Big Daddy, bonded for life to a single little one. When you are apart for too long, your body begins to shut down like a coma. As long as the girl is in the rapture, you are trapped here as well. The name of your little one is Eleanor Lamb, daughter of Sophia. She is kept at Fontaine Futuristics on the other side of the city. You must go there and save her before it is too late.
It's already very interesting. As she mentioned, not every Big Daddy later on was linked to a single little sister. But we were, so as long as she's here, we can't leave Rapture. Okay, and there's a lovely splashing close-up, and walking straight into a trap. There we go. You're still crying, but you're dead. So trap rivets will never fire against you for some reason, even though these aren't the ones we placed. There we go, trap rivets. So alternate ammo for our rivet gun. And really, really nice, because that we can put on walls like this. And just make a nice bit of traps. Which is very, very cool indeed. Let's think quick. I think there's an office around here. Yeah, but we only can access that from the other side. Yeah, okay. Let's turn around and let's head into this place. Another dead body. Not that there's much in here. God damn it, stop flying in front of me. And improving on Su Chong's work.
Dr. Su Chong's death was a nasty blow to the protector program, but I'm gradually settling into his role, picking up the slack that his carelessness left behind. We are gaining steam again, but I'm not satisfied. Yes, the Big Daddy defends the girl, but he is programmed only for the fight, like a sheepdog who wanders off unless a wolf is tearing at his flock. When no aggressor is present, he regards his little sister as he might a common houseplant. We need something more. Something stronger. An unbreakable physiological bond.
So there we go, indicating the start of the research that caused the gene bond between Little Sister and Big Daddy, forcing them to stay together. So that was Jill Alexander, the guy I mentioned before, the scientist that took over Su Chong's work after he was killed by a Big Daddy. Let's take another look around. Don't think there's too much around here, just a bit of loot. And a first aid kit, always handy. Train platform, that's where we're headed. So here we go. Can we hack this one? Let's hack this one as well. And blue. And what did we get? What did we get? Drill fuel. Okay, never mind. I don't need drill fuel. Don't need anything else, actually. I should stop hacking stuff that I don't really need. So yeah, Rapture is kind of falling to disrepair because there's leaks everywhere. Which you might think that would cause everything to crumble, but apparently it doesn't. It just fills up water.
Carry on the family name.
There we go, another splicer over there. Double headshot should take care of him. These things won't fire at me, so I might as well leave them here. And then we're gonna... because we arrived at a ticket booth. So hello, Tenenbaum. Look at that, a nice modeled Tenenbaum this time.
You see? This is why I must fight Sophia Lam. She is using the new little ones for something. And I have returned to rescue them. If I do not, more children will die for my sins. And the Rapture nightmare it will repeat forever. Now, we must talk...
Citizens of Rapture, this is Subject Delta. Behind that mask hides an enemy of the people, without soul or sympathy. It is a beast apart, and as family, we must tear out its jaw and drive it back into the sea.
That doesn't sound comfortable.
Lam will take this place apart to fight you. Please hold back the splicers until we escape.
That's another really nice thing about Bioshock 2. I'm gonna set a few traps in the meantime. The characters... okay. The characters in Bioshock 2 actually have fully modeled... well, models. Character models. Because the previous game only had a model for Andrew Ryan and for Atlas. Well, the very, very aggressive variant of Atlas. There we go, let's blow those guys up. You need to be careful because I think there's a camera over there. So if I go over here... yeah. Let's go with telekinesis. There we go. And there we go. I think that's the last one. As you might have noticed as well, yeah, protector, there
you.
We go.
Now I must leave you, and I am sorry for this, but there are others I must help before the city drowns. This man Sinclair, he is an ally, and will guide you to Eleanor. Goodbye, Herr Delta. And good luck.
And Sinclair was the other scientist that was mentioned by Su-Chong in the previous
game. A bona fide knight in armor, complete with iron horse. The name's Augustus Sinclair Sport, Esquire. Old Tenenbaum and I share an interest in the old Fontaine building, the very same place you'll find Eleanor Lamb. I think you and I can do business. Take the train to Ryan Amusements. I'll see you shortly.
So that's Augustus Sinclair, a very sly fella, looking to take over Fontaine Futuristic, in fact. And that's actually really cool as well, that we might eventually end up in Fontaine Futuristics, because we've seen a lot of propaganda for it in the previous game as well. But now we might actually get a chance to get there as well and discover it a bit. So, next up is boarding the train towards Ryan Amusements, which is the next area we need to go to. And there we're going to meet Augustus Sinclair. I'm just going to quickly take a look around. Looks like this is something we can break down. There we go, thank you for that. And I think that's pretty much everything. Don't think I missed anything, because you can't actually get inside of the boot that Tenenbaum occupied. So that's too bad. But yeah, because can you actually even push the button anymore? No, okay. We can't. Okay, so with that said, I'm gonna take a little break. When we get back, we're gonna board the train and head to Ryan's Amusements. But before that, I would like to thank you all for watching. If you enjoyed the episode, don't forget to like it right here on YouTube. And hopefully you forgive me my voice, because I'm kind of losing it right at the moment. But thanks again and obviously for watching. If you enjoyed the episode, don't forget to like it right here on YouTube. And if you haven't already, don't forget to give it a thought to subscribe to my channel, because I really appreciate any support you guys can give me. So thanks again and obviously for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video or series. Goodbye!